This conference will now be recorded. This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning, participants, and good morning to everyone. Sorry for the delay. The respected speaker of today's session, beloved HOD EEEE Department of RMD Engineering College, Dr. V. Tamilselvi, participants from various colleges, a warm welcome and good morning to one and all present. Now, for starting the one-week FDP session, I invite the HOD EEEE Department of RMD Engineering College to address the gathering. Welcome you, ma'am. Please, ma'am. Ma'am, HOD, ma'am. Ma'am Kargurli ma'am. Kargurli ma'am. Kargurli ma'am. Kargurli ma'am. Ma'am Kargurli ma'am.
உமா மேம் சுமித்ரா பேசுறேன். எச்ஓடி மேம்க்கு கனெக்ட் ஆகல, ஆடியோ கனெக்ட் ஆகலப்பா. நான் உங்களுக்கு கால்
பண்ணேன்,
உங்களுக்கு ஆடியோ கனெக்ட் ஆகல. சரி ஓகேப்பா. ஓகே ஓகே.
உமா மகேஸ்வரி மேம்.
A particular literary work can be copyrighted. Okay. Computer program literary work can be copyrighted. What about the technicality behind? What about the functionality behind the computer program? That we complete.
Uma Mageshwari ma'am.
Ma'am, yes ma'am.
Ma'am, this is Dhanalakshmi ma'am. I think it's getting delayed.
Yes ma'am, we are starting ma'am. Sorry for the delay ma'am.
I think you can proceed with the thing.
Yes ma'am.
Sorry sir, this is because, hello, am I audible?
Yes. Yes, ma'am, audible, ma'am.
I'm sorry, ma'am, this is because of.
Can I go with the introduction, ma'am?
Yes, of course.
Okay, sorry, participants, for the delay due to network issues. Let me give a brief introduction about the today's speaker. Dr. M. Prabhakar is completed his BE from University of Madras in the year 1998. He obtained his MA degree with specialization in power electronics and drives from Bharathidasan University in the year 2000. During the year 2012, he completed his PhD from Anna University in the area of resonant DC-DC converters. He has about 20 years of teaching experience at UG and PG level. He received the Outstanding Teacher Award for the year 2009. He was involved as a co-principal investigator and received seed fund worth rupees 3.4 lakh. He delivered about 30 keynote addresses and technical talks at various seminars, conferences, and workshops. He has published about 35 papers in various international journals and conferences. He is a reviewer for various international journals like IEEE Transaction on Industrial Electronics, IET Power Electronics, Renewable and Sustainable Energy Reviews, International Transaction on Electrical Engineering System, etc. His area of interest include DC-DC converter topologies for DC microgrids and power converters for renewable energy application.
ఇప్పుడు వెళ్ళినప్పుడు అక్కడ మీకు సైన్ ఇన్ అని ఉంటుంది చూడండి
ప్లీజ్ పుట్ యువర్ మైక్ థాంక్ యూ At present, he is working as professor in the School of Electrical Engineering, SCLECT, at VIT Chennai. I am very happy to welcome you, sir. Thank you, sir. Sorry, participants, for the delay.
Uma Maheshwari.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Good morning, all. Good morning, all. I am Tamilselvi, HOD of EEE Department. I would like to welcome you all. Participants for this FTP on this third day on behalf of our management department as well as the organizers. And I would also like to welcome our session speaker, Prabhakar sir. I would like to welcome you, sir, as well as I would like to thank you for accepting our requisition for presenting this webinar. Thank you, sir. And once again, I would like to welcome all the participants. Without you, we cannot conduct this FTP successfully. Thank you once again. Now I am handing over the session to sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Very good morning to all the participants. I hope I am audible.
You are audible, sir.
Yes, okay, sir. Fine. I'll share my screen and then I'll carry on my session. It's a new mode. It is likely to take some time. New mode for all of us. Is the screen visible to all the participants over there? Screen is visible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All right. All right. Very happy to meet you through this modem. This is this mode rather. This is very, very new to me. This is my first FTP session. Of course, I have handled a few classes, but then that is different, and this is going to be entirely different for the entire teaching fraternity. Just before joining this or in due course, this is likely to come up in a big way. And I found that there were around 120 participants, which is actually a very, very, very good number. Especially this mode gives us a lot of freedom, but there are certain pitfalls, the connectivity issues. And then we have other routines as well, because everybody will be using this mode. So we do not know how to manage our time, or at least initially we'll find it difficult. All right. having said all those things, it gives me a pleasure to not actually see you all, but in a way, yes, interact with you all, and that's the proper term. So in case you know, I'll be presenting on power converters for DC microgrid. In case you have some doubts or clarifications, you can put it in chat mode. I would request Professor Uma Maheshwari ma'am to read that chat in between. You can feel free to interrupt and you can read that. Or in case somebody has a doubt, you can always unmute and then you can speak over. That will be a better thing to do. Because opening a chat and then the transition from, let's say, one window, one screen to another screen is likely to take up some time. So you can feel free to interrupt. Just unmute and then speak if you have that rights or authority to do. Fine. All right. Now I'll start my presentation. Now I'll be presenting on, as I said earlier, the power converters for DC microgrid. Now, can you see the next screen? Is it moving?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. Now, these are the basic references on which my talk would be built on. These are four or five journal papers which I have published along with my team members. So that's the upfront thing. My entire presentation will be on these four references. One moment. I'll take a pointer so that I can move freely.
Sir,
yes, ma'am.
Yes, sir. We are audible now, sir.
Okay. Fine. Now, as far as the session goes, I'll give you I'll give you some basic introductory facts. All of us will be knowing that, and then I'll pass on to the actual converter, actual problem that we are looking at, and how do we address those issues? Where are power converters going to be important for us? We have done a lot of practical converters, not simulation, practical implementation parts, and that is how we have got all these publications. I'll be sharing few converters, few of those converters, and finally we will see where this is going to lead us. Now, if we take the renewable energy sources, they are coming up in a big way. They are supported by two or three things. Three things, actually. One is the government policy. The other one is the unexplored potential as on date, and then the technical needs. If you look at the government policies, they are encouraging renewable energy sources because we know that they have got a lot of potential. So we want to tap all those potentials, or the government of India is interested in tapping up all those potentials of potential of renewable energy sources. And then because there is a huge gap between the demand and the supply, we need to bridge that gap. We need to bring down that gap. This is where renewable energy is going to be helpful to us. Therefore, based on all, not only that, there is a commercial aspect as well. We in case there are independent power producers, like say Tata Power, Adani Power, or some other power companies. So those independent power producers, they can generate their own power and then they can sell that generated power to the consumers. So in that way, there is a lot of business or commercial potential as well. As a result, there is a lot of scope in using the renewable energy source. of course, my attention is only on PV because wind is also there, PV is also there. PV is where I personally believe that a lot of improvements can be done, at least from the connectivity aspect. Wind mechanical aspect is involved. There is, therefore, setting up a wind, let's say, tower or wind energy conversion system, a lot of design details which are going to be a little bit complicated, that is also going to be involved. Therefore, my focus of this talk, entire talk, will be on PV-fed systems. So, if we take PV-fed systems, so we can arrange the PV panels in various ways. One is going to be, I have shown three panels. So, one is going to be in series connected manner, wherein we connect one panel, the output from one panel with the other, and then connect it to a common DC bus. Before this, I believe all of us know that the output from the PV panel is going to be voltage magnitude is going to be less. Therefore, the necessity of meeting the requirement, matching the load requirement comes in. Therefore, we think of connecting the panels in series. Because I haven't answered that question, I simply jump to connecting in series and just answering this. So one way is to just connect the panels in series. We know that series connected panels, they give us the voltages get added up and then we can connect them to the DC bus. This gives the voltage requirement that can be met. Another way is we can have the panels in parallel so that we are able to generate, we are able to extract more power. The power consumption capability we can enhance, and then we can connect it to a common DC bus again. So we have these two arrangements. One is series connected, the other one is parallel connected configuration. But there are some drawbacks. If we have a series connected configuration, in case there is shading, in case there is shade falling on, let's say, one or two panels, the voltage level is going to be coming down. So let's say if we have partial shading, that's a common term. Let's say the panels are partially shaded, not completely shaded, but partially shaded. Then the output from each panel is going to reduce based on the magnitude of shading. Therefore, the net voltage which is available at the common DC bus, that will reduce. So that is actually a drawback of parallel connected, series connected PV configuration. Even parallel connected, same thing happens. But parallel connected, because they are in parallel, the voltage level is going to be common. So if one voltage level falls down, all the three voltage levels or voltage levels of all the three panels come down, power level is going to fall drastically. So that is one major drawback of series and parallel connected configurations. So we now have seen what is the actual drawback. It is due to partial conditions, partial shaded conditions, or I'll write it as partial shading. This creates some difficulties. Actually, it reduces the required voltage level, reduces the voltage level. Voltage level at the DC bus, that we need to understand. Now, why am I stressing about this DC bus voltage level? Because loads will be connected to the DC bus. So the voltage at that DC bus should be maintained a constant. Something like what we have right now in AC systems. AC bus voltage, if you take single phase AC, it's 230 volt, 50 hertz in India. So that voltage level has to be maintained. Similarly, in DC bus, if we are using DC form, electrical energy in DC form, that I'll be covering that at the end of my presentation in prospects. So if we are using electrical energy in DC form, then the voltage at that DC port, that must be maintained a constant. I have mentioned some common DC bus voltages. 380 volt DC bus is pretty common. 400 volt is also common. 400 volt is used in data centers. Again, 380, somebody prefers it for data centers. Or if you want to invert it, if you want in AC form, you can always invert DC into AC. So, and then use a modulation technique along with the filter. For that case, 380, 400, near that range, it will be required. Other voltage levels are 120 volt is there. 48 volt DC level was tried in automobiles. Right now, they have settled down to 42 volt. That's another standard DC bus voltage. 200 volt.
Sir, your voice is not audible, sir.
Prabhakar sir, 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 your voice is not audible, sir.
Yes, ma'am, dear participant, please wait. I call sir. Just wait.
I'm really sorry. I had been I presented few things. I do not know where it left. Probably yeah. Am I audible now? Earlier.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Fine. In case I am not audible. Stop me then and there, because I have spoken for around 2-3 minutes and then certain things have gone by. Fine. Now, whatever I had, I presume that from this point onwards, I was not audible. Therefore, I repeat very quickly. I'll try to pass on to the other things. I was talking about the problems with series and parallel connected configurations. If we have PV panels which are connected in series, partial shading will affect the voltage available at the common DC bus. If we have parallel connected configuration, yes, partial shading will affect, but because they are in parallel, voltage level obviously will be less. So in either case, we need a proper power electronic converter as an interface. That's the takeaway message. And after that, we find that when we have parallel connected configuration, we can actually connect the output of each and every individual PV panel. Through a DC-DC converter, we can actually connect the outputs from the DC-DC converters, and then we can arrive at the required DC bus voltage level. This is what I was talking so far. Now, I have displayed a case where many PV panels are going to be connected in parallel, but individually, each panel is connected to a DC-DC converter. So if I have, let's say, panel one here, I'll name it as P1. There will be one converter, I'll name it as converter one. And if I have the second panel, which I name as, let's say, PV2, the converter associated with that second panel is going to be C converter two. In this way, I am having an arrangement where one panel will be connected to one converter at a time. Finally, the outputs of those individual DC-DC converters are going to be connected in series. This you need to understand. See, the output from this DC converter one will be plus minus. The second converter again like this. Similarly, you have N converters which are connected in series. The outputs from the DC-DC converters, they are connected in series, not the panels. As a result, there are two advantages. Number one, if one panel fails, we can take it out. And then we can try to rearrange the configuration, and then we can arrive at the required DC bus voltage level here. So this is where we need the required DC bus level. It could be 380, it could be 230, it could be decided based on the user's requirement, because I have drawn a grid connected case that too you can assume this to be a single phase grid connected case. So you need somewhere around 380 to 400 volt. That is the requirement. 380 to 400 volts would be required here. With this plate, top plate being positive, bottom plate being negative. One advantage. Another advantage is individually you can track the maximum power point of each and every PV panel. Let's say you can have a proper algorithm in place and then you can track the maximum point of panel one, MPPT of panel one. Similarly, you can have another algorithm for converter two, and then you can track the second panel's individual peak power point, maximum peak power point of, let's say, panel two. So individually, you can track the maximum power points of all those panels. This is the other advantage. But the problem is you need n number of converters. All right. So instead, you can have a single converter. That is also there. You can have one huge converter, and then you can try to interface the PV panel with the load. Right? That's another arrangement. Now, what we are looking at, we are trying to looking at how do we interface this low voltage PV input, low voltage PV input to the required. This is where we need the load will be at the AC side, but we are exactly looking at this point. This is going to be the high voltage. High voltage, don't imagine kilovolts. Compared to the PV voltage level, the required voltage level is going to be huge, more than 10 times. So this is the high voltage bus, high voltage DC bus. This is our requirement. How do we interface the low voltage PV input to the high voltage DC bus? We need to have boost or boost derived converters. This is where the solution comes, fine. So one way of addressing this problem is just have a transformer based DC-DC converters, put a transformer, adjust the turns ratio. Yes, transformers, they work only in AC condition, but when you have switched cases, you have transformerized, transformer based DC-DC converters also. You can switch at high frequencies, bring down the size of the transformer. Example is flyback, forward, etc. Basic converter. Similarly, you can have high gain isolated topologies. So it's pretty easy. You can have power flowing from, let's say, load side to source side as well. If you have a battery, you can charge the battery. But the problem is, because you are going to have a large step-up ratios, let's say 12 volt to 200 volts, or 60 volt to 360 volt. 60 volt is too high. 24 volts to 380 volts. The conversion ratio is going to be more than 10. Remember this very, very clearly. The circuit breaker rating will be too high in isolated configuration. On the other hand, you can have non-isolated configurations where you just need few converters which are going to give you the required voltage gain. Voltage gain, V0, VDC bus by Vin, V0 by Vin. That's the nomenclature which I will be using throughout this presentation. That's voltage gain. That will be more than 10. So we need very small transformers, very small inductors, magnetic elements whose size is going to be smaller. And then the circuit breakers, they are going to be off again. Smaller power rating, but the problem is interrupting DC circuits, DC currents. That is an issue. We need to address it. Yes, there are circuit breakers which operate at 1000 volt DC and which can easily break around 630 ampere. They are there. Finally, I'll demonstrate or show you those things. So now we are up to the basics. So how do we meet the voltage gain requirement? We start from the basics. This may be very, very, very basic for many of you, but still we need to understand the issues with the boost converter so that we are able to think about novel solutions. Now, classical boost converter, it has got two semiconductor devices. One is a switch, the other is a diode. There will be energy storage inductor and a filter capacitor at the load end. Based on the way we switch the devices, namely the switch and diode, which are indicated as S and D, they will be turned on and turned off in a complementary manner. So to understand this, remember, there are two devices. They will be operating in a complementary way, which means only one device will be turned on at a time. Both devices should not be on, will not be on. So we had designed in practical cases, we had practically we had designed a boost converter with these specifications just to see what is the voltage gain that is possible. Now whatever we see here is the input voltage. First one is the input voltage. This is Vin, which is 24 volts, 24.1. For ease of mathematical computation, I'll name it as 24 volts. And the output that we get here is 46.9 volts. This is V naught. And we have the pulse width, which is, we generally have a term called as duty cycle D, which will be given by on time divided by total time. So on time over here is 10.41. Both are in microseconds. I'll leave the unit. Time period is 19.81. So the duty ratio, duty cycle will be around approximately 0.5. Slightly more, but never worry. So we are able to meet 24 to 48 volts. Remaining 1.1 volt, obviously you have a practical diode, practical semiconductor devices. Therefore, due to drops, you have a reduced output voltage. V naught is reduced due to drops. And this voltage drop occurs across the stray resistance of the L, across, I'll write it as RL, maybe the stray resistance, just to be clear, the diode as well. Switch also has got some power dissipation. So when you compute the efficiency, that comes into play. I name it as the on state resistance of the switch. These things play a role in bringing down the output voltage from the expected level. But then it's not alarming. It's just 1.1 volts. From 0.5, you slightly increase to 0.5 to 0.53, you'll be able to meet the output voltage. Not an issue at all. Perfectly fine. But then what we need is, we need to get on with 380 volt, not 48 volt. So to get on with 380 volt, we need to increase the duty cycle, right? So you can easily compute what is the duty cycle that is required. We need a voltage gain. I'll just indicate here. V naught by Vin is the voltage gain, which will be pretty much more than 10. Even if you take it to be approximately equal to 10, V naught by Vin mathematically is given by 1 by 1 minus D. Therefore, this would mean D is the duty cycle. Duty cycle should be around 0.8. So this is where we need to operate. Are we able to operate at 0.8? Will we get a voltage gain of 10? That is what we are trying to see now. The answer lies in these two things. Duty cycle is 16.41 divided by 19.81. This is close to 0.8, 0.85, slightly more than 0.8. But the problem is V in is 5.52, V naught is just 24 volts. This is V naught. Whereas look at this point, you need to get 30 volts for 5.5 volts input. There is a drop of 6 volts. 6 volt for a 30 volt output, that in percentage terms is 20%, not permitted at all. That's the problem. But why do we get this problem? We need to understand. Only then we can solve that issue. Why do we get this problem? Now I have shown two current waveforms. One is current through the switch, another one is current through the diode. For instance, this waveform is current through the switch, and probably I'll mark it in another color. Let's say blue, where this is current through the diode. Try to recollect the operating principle. Only one of the devices can operate at a time. Simultaneously, they cannot operate. They should not operate. Unfortunately, when we operate at a duty cycle of 0.8, we have a case where, look at this point, let's say this point till this point. We have both the devices operating. So this region both devices or operator. By devices, I am referring to diode and the switch. Both the devices are operating. Therefore, it will be lossy. To understand, I have I have presented the circuit here. When both the devices operate, current will flow through the inductor and the switch one path. There will be current flowing from the switch, from the supply, inductor, diode, and the load as well. Second path. Which means inductor, either it has to charge or it has to discharge. It can't do both simultaneously. That is what we are forcing to do. Therefore, the take-home message is, this case is called as extreme duty ratio operation. Which is a case where duty ratio is more than 0.8. So under an extreme duty ratio operation, we will not get the desired output, not preferred. This is the take-home message. You don't want a case where duty ratio is more than 0.8, limited to well below 0.8. So D, have it in the range of 0.5 to point maximum 0.7, not more than that. Practically, from our experience, from me and my team's experience, limiting D to 0.65, 0.7, 0.7 itself is too tight. If you want to have D equal to 0.7, you need to choose the devices perfectly. Very good devices, very expensive devices. Bring down the frequency as well. When you bring down the frequency, inductor size goes. So these are the issues when you operate at D equal to 0.5. All right. So boost converter will not give what we need, will not give gain of more than 10. So what are the solutions? These things I have discussed. One problem is there. Another problem is, this is actually the input current which is shown, IN. Now IN contains a lot of ripples. It is undulating. It is not constant. When we have current which is going to be containing ripples, tracking the maximum power point will be difficult. So input current contains ripples. You prefer ripple-free current for PV, for easier MPPT tracking, for easier MPPT implementation. Smooth and ripple-free current is preferred, something like this. Smooth and ripple free is preferred. So we now have two issues. One is the voltage gain issue, another is the ripple issue. These are the problems. Voltage gain is limited, extreme duty ratio operation that leads to excessive voltage drop and reduced power transfer level. And then you have large input current ripple, very difficult to implement MPPT. Power handling is an issue, but you can always address that depending on the choice of your devices and depending on the inductor value, magnetic energy storage element value. We'll try to attack one problem at a time. Probably I will pause for a moment in case the audience or the participants, if you have any questions so far, you can post them to me. Maybe around 30 seconds to 1 minute, not more than that. Any questions from the audience?
Sir, there is no messages in the chat box, sir, till now.
Okay. Okay. So nobody has. They can unmute and speak as well. They haven't done. Can they unmute and speak? Do they have that permission to do? The software, does it permit them?
Yes, sir. They can unmute and speak. Sir.
They can unmute and speak. Okay, fine. All right. Again, I reiterate, in case you have doubts, in case you want to clarify something, unmute and speak. Fine. No more queries are there. That's what I'm pressing. I'll move on. All right. Now, first issue that we will address is there is a large input current ripple. So what we will do is we'll try to have interleaving mechanism. Interleaving mechanism works like this. We have one converter, we have a source, one converter and one load. We try to take another converter, try to have one more block, try to connect them in parallel. You can arrange n such blocks in parallel. Let's say you treat your boost converter as a brick, one brick, another boost converter, another brick. You have them in parallel, arrange them in parallel, interleave them. You can interleave n such bricks. And when we try to do this, we try to operate each boost converter, each block, each brick at a time. So we need to switch on the devices in a proper way. What I have shown here is a two-phase interleaved boost converter, two-phase IBC structure, where you have switches S1, D1, L1, S2, D2, L2 for the second converter. Now, S1 and S2, they will be phase shifted by 180 degrees. Therefore, when S1 is on, S2 will be off. They are going to be complementary. And then I operate at a duty cycle of 0.5. I make sure that they are operated at 0.5, not more than that. The beauty is, when S1 is conducting, IL1 will flow. So when I turn on S1, IL1 will flow. This will be the path for current, IL. When I turn off, there won't be current through S1, whereas there will be current through some other path. Similarly, when I turn off S1, S2 is going to be on. Therefore, S2 will have another current. That current, as I said, will be phase shifted by 180 degrees. So if you compute if you just try to observe the individual current waveforms, they will be like this. They will be phase shifted. But remember, the net current at this junction, I in, will be equal to simple Kirchhoff's law. I in will be equal to IL1 plus IL2. That's all. Therefore, both currents will get added and we'll have a smooth ripple field current. Ripples will be cancelled out. We can do this for n number of phases. One advantage, another advantage is, because we are going to connect converters in parallel, power handling capability increases, something what we saw in our parallel connected PV panel configurations. That is going to be enormous. Reliability will also be more. When one converter is going to fail, you can take it away, you can bypass that, and then you can keep working. So interleaving gives us higher power handling capability, ripple-free operation, and reliable operation, enhanced reliability. These are the advantages. But how many interleaved phases can you keep adding? The answer lies in how many number of gate pulses are we able to generate. Nowadays we have FPGA processors, so you can have n number of gate pulses, ideally. But practically, when you have more than three phases, see, totally there are only, let's say, 360 degrees, okay? So, I mean, for one cycle. Again, when you compute one on, one off, then in that way, it boils down to D being equal to 1/3. 100% of the total time should be shared by three phases, which will be 100 by 3, that will be 33.33, 1 by 3. When you have four phases, then the duty cycle comes down to 0.25, five phases, 20%, etc. Only then ripples will be cancelled. Therefore, when you increase the number of phases, the utility of the devices, that is going to come down. The time duration for which you are allowing the inductance, the switch to carry current, to carry power, that is going to come down. Therefore, practically, we limit the number of interleaved phases to 3. We don't go beyond that. If you want even larger power handling capability, have three-phase IBC. You have one more parallel three-phase IBC. That is the way we do. Okay? So we can just have an interleaved configuration to take care of the ripples. Again, we tested same configuration. Now we are having two converters operated in parallel. We tried doing that. Now the wonderful thing that we got is shown here. This is IL1, this is IL2. The first one is IL1, current through the first inductor. Second one is current through the second inductor. Remember, these are practical waveforms, not simulated, not theoretical waveforms. total current is this one. Now, if you observe this total input current, perfect constant waveform, but for these niggles, these things, they are not going to cause a big issue because the remaining duration you have fairly constant current. Therefore, the take home message is ripple free current is achieved. One of our difficulties was in getting the ripple free current, that is now solved. Next is voltage gain, but voltage gain is still an issue. We have an input voltage, take it as 24, 23.9, take it as 24, but voltage gain is still limited to 2 only because we are operating at a duty cycle 0.5. It is same as the classical boost convert. Remember, they are only in parallel, so you can't expect a voltage gain. That's unfair. Input current ripple, we have addressed, user interleaving technique. Voltage gain is still limited, so we need to enhance it. Why should we enhance it? Again, I get back to the first and foremost thing. We need a voltage gain of at least more than 10 because our input voltage is low. We need large output voltage. Right? So what do? We have these gain extension techniques. Voltage lift capacitor, voltage multiplier cell is there. Diode capacitor multiplier is also there. We have tried all these techniques, including coupled inductors. And I'll be presenting one after the other. So this is actually a classical interleaved boost converter. Structurally, if you do a simple modification, what we are doing here is we are trying to connect the output, let's say after this port, we are dropping it to capacitor C0. Instead, don't drop it, you try to just hold it, push it up, just push it, push this voltage up, store it somewhere, don't allow it to drain to the capacitor. Don't do this. If you are able to achieve this, then that gives us enhanced voltage gain, which means one boost converter will act as a base. Again, another boost converter will be the second step. First step, second step. Okay. So if we have such an arrangement, then that is going to be enhanced. That is going to be better for us. So now, the output from S1, it is pushed to C lift. We are storing the energy there. Then the total energy, the output from converter 2 will also be available at this node. Both these outputs are pumped up to C0. This is called as voltage lifting. So lift capacitor, this capacitor C lift, does that lifting function, voltage lift technique. This is voltage lift technique. Fine. Now, again, we have implemented this converter. So this is the output from the voltage lift converter, two phase interleaved boost converter. Again they are interleaved, but they are lifted. Now look at the voltage level. Output voltage is 93.2, this is 24. So we wanted 24 to 96, we ended up with 93.2. there is a voltage gap, voltage reduction of somewhere around 2.8 volts. This is the gap. Am I right? Mathematics? Yeah, 2.8 volts, which is again meaningful. Earlier we saw one boost converter gave us a voltage drop of 1.2 volts, I remember, if I am correct. Two circuits, you have one more set of additional components, they introduce more losses, more voltage drop, understandable. But is it alarming? The answer is no. For 96, you are getting 93.2, fair enough. Voltage gain is now doubled. What about ripples? Ripples, they are also nullified because it's interleaving, switches are operated at 0.5 duty cycle, input current is ripple free. Iin is ripple free. Absolutely no problem. But voltage gain of 2, is it enough? Again, the answer is no. We need a voltage gain of 10, at least 10. So next is introduce another set of voltage gain extension technique, which is called as a voltage multiplier cell. We will be using two diodes and two capacitors. Insert this VMC in between the boost converter and the output. So there the boost converter, the output from the boost converter is given to one VMC, again another VMC, another VMC. That can also be done. You can do it in a cascaded manner. So when you do that, actually theoretically you can have n number of VMCs, but remember you are adding more and more number of elements. That is going to definitely have an effect, fine. So practically, is this going to be a advisable solution? Ideally or theoretically, these are the governing equations. When you have n number of VMCs inserted in series with the output from a boost converter, the net output voltage will be 1 by 1 minus d for the boost converter, plus you have n number of VMCs. So it will be n plus 1 by 1 minus d. Switch stress and other things, they are given here. So we again tested this. Practically, is it going to work? We wanted 24 to 240, which is a voltage gain of 10. I have indicated here. So this gives, this means a gain of 10 is required, 10 gain, this is required. Remember, duty ratio is 0.7. We are actually operating at the brim of the permissible limit. We tested this, we fabricated, and then, yeah, these are the output voltage levels. The output voltage level is V0, what we have got is somewhere around 220 volts. Whereas we wanted a 240, we have ended up with the required voltage level is 240. We ended up with 220, 20 volt difference. Out of 240, that's close to 10%. But from 24 to 220, 24 volts input to 220 volts output, gain value, it's more, somewhere around probably 9 times, close to 9 times, or very, very close to 9 times, if not slightly more than. Yes. But what about input current? Input current, is it ripple free? The answer is no. This is actually the input current, IN, has ripples, it contains ripples. So ripples also have to be taken care of. Voltage gain, yes, we have found one way of enhancing the voltage gain. Therefore, the next step would be, ripple current can be reduced by interleaving. Voltage gain can be achieved by using VMC and the voltage. Make a hybrid combination of all these techniques. Use interleaving for reducing the ripples. Use voltage lift for doubling the voltage gain. Use VMCs for further increasing the voltage level. That is what we did in our third converter. This is actually the two-phase IBC with the lift configuration. And then in this, we added five VMC stages. So totally, we had a voltage gain of 2 plus 5 by 1 minus d, which was 7 by 1 minus d, 2 plus n. Actually, we had 2 plus 5, which is 7. Now look at the voltage gain. We moved from 24 to 336. So gain will be 336 divided by 24, which is definitely more than 10, probably around 12, 13 should be around that. Okay. So this was published, incidentally published in one of the Scopus Index journals. The output, this is the photograph of the converter. See how many diodes are there. 5 VMC networks would mean 5 × 4, 20 components, plus the lift stage. So it has got a lot of components. Component count is definitely very, very high. Therefore, the voltage level is supposed to come down. We wanted 336, we are at 328. Fair enough. Voltage gain is enhanced. This gets a tick. But because we have used more number of components, you can't keep adding components one after the other. Power level comes down, voltage drop across the diode will also increase, so output voltage will come down. This is one drawback. Don't use more number of components. So what is the other technique? The method is, try to pass on power to some other stage. How do we transfer power to some other stage? Coupled inductor plays an important role here. So we have two coupled inductors, L1P, L1S. L1P, L1S combination. This is one coupled inductor. I'll write it as, I'll represent that as CI. Another coupled inductor is L2P, L2S combination. L1, L2 will be the simple, let's say, discrete inductance. Instead of that, you replace by the primary winding of the coupled inductor. So then this will be the second coupled inductor. Secondary side, we have connected other elements as well, C1S, D1S, D02, etc. And finally, we have cascaded. Instead of using a voltage multiplier cell, here we have used a diode capacitor multiplier. Performs the same function with a reduced number of components. So we tried this, and then this got published in, as I had put this in second slide reference. This is one of those reference papers. So the output from this, the photograph of the converters, which you can see for yourself, and then the output from the converter that is available here. So V in is 18, it says 18.5, but actual test result it was only 18. Because of these spikes, it is slightly increased. The output from the DSO is increased. Most important thing and the happy fact is this: V naught is 384 volts. So from 18.5, we have traveled to 380 volt, which is a standard DC bus voltage level. Remember this very, very clear. It's a standard DC bus voltage level. We are able to achieve that. So 18 to 380, if you compute the voltage gain, it will be around 21.11. We wanted a gain of more than 10. We struggled getting a gain of 10 in a boost converter. We doubled it by using voltage lift technique. We further enhanced it by using voltage multiplier cell. It had used so many components. Therefore, now we are trying to bring down the components without compromising on voltage gain, without compromising on input current. That's what we are doing. And remember, duty cycle, very, very within, I mean, very safe value, well within the limits. Duty cycle D, if you try to compute, it is 11.33 divided by, it will be around 49.77 is the frequency, total switching frequency. Somewhere around 20 microsecond will be the total time period. So duty cycle D will be close to 0.55. If I remember correctly, it will be somewhere around 0.55, which is safe. That is the take home message. So even at safe duty cycle values, we are able to meet the voltage gain of 21.11. How about input current ripple? This is, of course, just to tell what is the effect of having the switch at the closer to the input side. Remember, the switch does not see huge voltage levels. See, this voltage is just 36 volts. If you compute, it just sees only 36 volt level as a stress across it. These spikes, yes, they are an issue. These spikes are a problem. Spikes maybe, but we have never used any snubbers. No snubbers have been used. No other mechanisms to bring down the spikes have been used. Simply just run the circuit, test the circuit like that, you get this. Right? Whereas when you use a snubber circuit, when you use protection mechanisms, you can bring down the voltage spikes. So that also has to be noted down here. By using suitable protection circuits, spikes can be brought down or eliminated. Sometimes you can eliminate, we eliminate also. When you have a very good design of the coupled inductor, you can completely nullify. Future work, we never encounter spikes. You will be able to see that. I'll project that as well. Can be brought down. All right. Now, this is about the voltage stress on the switch. And this is the dynamic response, because remember 380 volt is a common DC bus, so you can actually connect it to a 380 volt DC bus, have many converters operating in parallel, and then you can use it as a microgrid. Very small power level microgrid can be done. When under that situation, when load on the DC bus changes, you still should be able to meet the 380 volt level. Similarly, when the supply voltage undergoes a change, because it's connected from PV input, so input voltage will fluctuate. So when input voltage changes, then also we need to get the output constant. Therefore, these are called as line and load voltage regulation characteristics. So on the left hand side, so here we have the load regulation characteristics, load regulation characteristics, wherein the load current, as you see, keeps fluctuating from 416 milliampere, 346 milliampere is the minimum, and then it goes as high as 490 milliampere. So it keeps fluctuating. Still, the output voltage remains constant. Similarly, the input voltage, again, when it fluctuates, this is called as line voltage characteristics, line voltage regulation, line regulation characteristics. Even when input voltage changes, we are able to get a constant voltage at the output. Fine. So, which means this converter, if you design it properly with some protection mechanisms, you can use it to connect it to interface the PV panel to the DC micro. Fine. Now, we wanted to reduce the components. Therefore, we thought, why not have a boost converter cascaded and then use that. That was our other thought. This converter was fine. We had used a coupled inductor, it was fine. Another option was we tried to further enhance it. We wanted to enhance it and then see whether it performs in a better way as compared to the previous converter. So what configuration can be thought of? We thought, let's start from the basics. Have a boost converter connected to the other boost converter, then we will have what is called as a quadratic boost converter. So the configuration that is shown over here is a quadratic boost converter, which is abbreviated as QBC. And obviously, you will find that L1, C1, D1, of course, you don't have a switch, but that switch function is performed by D2 and S1 combination. This forms classical boost converter 1. And then the other configuration forms the other configuration, L2, S1, and D1, D0, this forms the second CBC, second classical boost converter. And we have cascaded them. C1 acts as the source for the second boost converter stage. What will be the voltage gain of QBC? So QBC, the gain is going to be 1 divided by 1 minus duty cycle squared. It's going to be quadratic. It's not doubled, it's squared, because one boost converter acts as the input to the next boost converter, subsequent boost converter. So the voltage will be squared. It is not doubled. Please understand. It's not two, but squared gives you very high voltage gain capability. Again, you can't get a voltage gain of more than, do some simple mathematics, you can't get more than gain of 10. So this is where we used our experience to be precise. Why not have, let's say, QBC structures in a cascaded way? That is where we thought of. And then, how is the screen? Are you able to see it clearly, or is it along with the?
Sir, it's
along with the written part, right?
Yes, sir. Okay, fine.
Let it be along with the written part. Please manage with that. No. Now. So here, you can even. Can I proceed further? Is the participant willing to say something?
Sorry. The black.
Can I proceed further?
Participants, please put a message whether we can proceed for a few more minutes, the chat box.
Do they need a break, ma'am? They need to pass for a few moments or?
Sir, from the participants, it is written, sir. We can proceed, sir.
Okay. Oh, because I have, okay, time is more. No? Okay, fine. I'll try to wind up. Fine. Sorry, I have overshot the time limit. Initially, I started off late. Okay. So now we have two QBC structures which are cascaded through this lift technique. So for this converter, of course, it's published in one of the journals. For this converter, the voltage gain will be 2 by 1 minus D square. One QBC has got 1 by 1 minus D square. It's being pushed up, so it will be 2 by 1 minus D square. Again, voltage level 24 to 380, duty cycle is 0.65 on the higher side, but you will get 376 was the output voltage, 376 was achieved. But input current again ripple free, interleaving technique has achieved this, has helped us achieve this. Next, we try to have one more gain extension stage. We used all the multi winding coupled inductors and then have two VMCs at the secondary side. So we were able to achieve again a higher voltage, 18 to 380 volt. So this is 18.2, this is 380. So this is 18 to 380 volt output was achieved. Again, output is ripple free. So these are some converters which are going to give us again the dynamic response is also fine, fair enough. So these are some converters which gives us the required voltage levels, 18 to 380 volt was possible. Now, where are we going to need this? Where will we be where will we be using this? If we take modern day appliances, LED lamps, inverter, air conditioners, washing machines, the first stage in all these appliances that's being used nowadays, that's actually a DC to AC rectifier. And then comes the other processes, which means the processing is going to happen. First stage is DC, input AC is being rectified. Utility is happening in DC form. Therefore, why should we rectify? Why not supply with pure DC itself? If we do that, the intermediate AC-DC rectifier can be eliminated. With that, we will be increasing the efficiency by 15 to 22%. Again, this is not theory, it is practice. Not only that, when we have a DC supply, we can actually interface the solar PV panel with our DC bus. Of course, through a proper power electronic converter, which we have come across so far. So the idea that that I'm trying to communicate is, let's say have a 24 volt or 18 volt PV panel on the rooftop of our homes, residences, put a power electronic converter, 24 volt to 380 volt DC bus. From that DC bus, you take it to all the appliances, have an inverter because they are working. Right now, they are working in AC. There are appliances which are readily working in DC native loads. So if you want to process, do the processes inside the appliances as we are doing right now. So that can be done. I'm not saying eliminate AC completely. No, you can coexist. It can coexist. In that way, we will be able to enhance the efficiency. And if you extrapolate this to existing AC supply systems, you can eliminate the intermediate levels. So all these things can be brought down. And then you can replace this with a very high gain, high power. You need high gain and you need high power as well. I am not a kid. I am not suggesting kilowatt level. It's going to be in megawatt level, transmission lines going to be in megawatt levels. Fine. Or you can have a local distribution, distributed generation. That can be done at a few kilowatts, few hundreds of kilowatts. So wherein we have the renewable sources at the input, couple all the renewable energy sources, have the power converter at the intermediate place. This is where our converter, which we have seen so far, comes into picture. And then supply all the loads as we do normally. This is another system. This is the prospect. And the challenge that we will be having when we have such a case is, because we have n number of sources, there will be n number of converters. When you have a number of converters, controlling them will be an issue. And when you connect them in parallel, the converters should not interface among themselves. What do I mean by among themselves? They try to communicate within themselves. Let's say converter 1 to converter 2, that will start speaking. Similarly, converter 2 to converter n, that will start communicating, I mean transfer power. they will try to transfer power from themselves within their load terminals, not to the load. That can be done. You can actually make it happen, meaning you can instruct converter one, you control converter one, converter two in such a way that both of them should transfer power only to the load, not among themselves. This is called as loop flow. So loop flows can be avoided. And we can eliminate this as well. Okay. So it's not a big deal, but it's a challenge. Now, other challenges would be, what will happen when there is a sudden rejection of load? Right now, if there is a sudden rejection of load, I think the best case is when our Modi ji wanted all of us to switch off our lights and then do something at 9 p.m. I have seen the load demand going down. I have seen that load curve. So that is an issue. When we have a power electronic converter, we need to bring down the gate pulse and then we need to regulate it. There are some issues. Similarly, how do we share the load? Are there mechanisms? Yes, there are mechanisms to share the load. Have what is called as a O-ring diode is there, and then have droop resistance can be controlled to avoid loop flows. There are techniques, but they are interesting challenges, right? So on that note, I would like to, of course, come to the summary. I would like to sum. These are some other challenges as well. So in summary, to summarize, historically DC was the form. Electrical energy was available in DC in first form, and then we all know the big war between Tesla and Edison. AC prevailed, and Nikola Tesla actually prevailed. Therefore, we are using AC. We are continuing to use AC for around 100 years, more than 125 years to be precise. But when we have DC, we can eliminate the power quality issues. Renewable energy sources can be suitably integrated, and then it is likely to be more beneficial. But there are challenges. Though they are attractive, circuit breakers will be a big task. Safety levels have to be evolved. Right now, they are not evolved. Not that they are not safe. People are trying various voltage levels, and there are no standard specified levels other than 380 volt. 1.1 kV is another standard, but people are, because of the lack of circuit breakers at various voltage levels, people are a bit hesitant to adopt DC completely. But then in the future, we will hope that DC and AC will continue to coexist. That's the way forward. One cannot replace the other, rather it should coexist. On that note, I would like to thank all of you. And if you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer all those questions.
Hello, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Sir, this is Dhanlakshmi, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead, ma'am.
I have a small doubt, sir. For all high applications, always it is isolated configurations are preferable. Am I right, sir? If we go for 380 volt and 400 volt DC bus, is it preferable to have isolated configurations where we can reduce the number of components to be less, and we can also have the voltage gain and boost up can be done through that transformer ratio? Is it possible, sir?
It is possible. Definitely, it is possible. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are audible.
Yeah, it is possible. Not that we are not doing. Transformers, they have got inherent drawbacks, as I was mentioning. The circuit, because of the voltage level, circuit breaker rating at one side will be pretty high. If you take the input side, input current rating will be too high. So you have to have a very huge circuit breaker of very high current rating at the input side if you use the transformer. On the other hand, if you use a DC-DC converter, non-isolated category, then you have to put a circuit breaker at the high voltage end, that the rating is going to be less. But then you have to deal with DC there. So yes, isolated configurations you can use. Yes.
Okay, sir. And one more, sir. The current was in the range of milliampere. So when it has been given to a battery, that is, when we want to charge the battery, will it be compatible, sir? So how do we make a battery to be charged from the supply water we generated?
battery charging is always bulk operation, it's not boost.
No sir, my question is the current what is the output current what you have achieved is of milliampere, will it be able to charge a battery? And that we are asking.
No, the answer is because we are having a load operating at 380 volt 240 volt level at 100 watts power, the current is in milliamperes. Load current from the converter is in milliamperes. For battery charging application, you will not use boost mode. Your battery voltage level will be around 12 volts, input will be at 24 volts, so it will be buck operation, it won't be boost operation.
Sir, I'm asking for a ED application where the battery is of high voltage batteries, HV batteries. Yes. In that case, what can it be, sir?
Not possible at all. The solution is when you, I can understand your question very clearly. You have a battery storage systems where you connect n number of batteries so that you end up with, let's say, 240 volt DC battery voltage level. And then your PV panel input is only at 24 volts. How do you charge the battery? Is this your question? Yes.
Yes, sir.
The answer is yes. Okay. The answer is from 24 volt, you can never push the electrical energy to 240 volt DC per system. It's very, 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 very difficult. You will never be able to do that. So if you have a 240 volt battery level, battery voltage level, your input must be more than 240 volt. Only then power can naturally flow from the higher potential to lower potential. That's the way to do it. Practically. Simulation wise you can do. Simulation is not a big issue. Practically you will never be able to charge a battery low voltage. Any other questions?
Sir, there is a question in the chat box, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Questions on the chat box? Okay.
Yes, sir. Which configuration of inverter?
Mr. Vignesh,
sir, Alex George.
Sorry. Yes, ma'am. Go ahead, ma'am. I'll listen to you. Before that, how do I switch off this share screen? Yeah, now I have found out. Okay. It becomes easier now. Yes, ma'am. Did I miss out any question? You read that because I'm able to see only Mr. Vignesh. A question from Mr. Vignesh. Is it difficult to maintain power quality due to power electronic components in converters? Straightforward answer, Mr. Vignesh, sir. Yes, it is difficult. Is there a solution? Again, yes. Active power filters are the solutions to combat power quality issues. Ma'am, any other question, ma'am? You were asking some.
Yes, sir. Mr. Alex George has asked one question, sir. Which configuration of inverter is best suited for PV panels?
Mr. Alex, sir, if you are online, can you unmute and speak? Because by configuration, what are you actually referring to? Because configuration was it asked earlier, ma'am? Mr. Alex, Dr. Alex, if you are there.
Yes,
Yeah, sir, which configuration of inverter is best suited? Again, what does he mean by configuration? Are you referring to string inverters or are you referring to central inverters? Are you referring to that or are you referring to voltage source, current source? Need some clarity over there. Okay. Can I pass on to the next? I'll pass on to the next question. Mr. Suresh has asked, how are the electrical transients problem overcome in this converter? Excellent question, sir. Thank you for the question. It's a very nice question, interesting question. See, simply because if we take the existing electrical system, there are energy storage damping elements due to our machines. Whereas in power electronic converters, we don't have any damping methods. Therefore, how do we overcome transience? We will never be able to overcome transience. If there is a transient spike, if that spike is big enough to kill a power electronic device, yes, the device is going to get damaged. That's it. So to avoid that, we can only have snubbers, some protective arrangements. Otherwise, we can't prevent it. One way. Another way is, if we have, we know that power electronic converters have got energy storage inductors and capacitors. Try to pre-charge them and then have some energy storage as a buffer, intermediate buffer, before we actually switch on. Then that is going to be helpful to us in some way. This is how we try to overcome the electrical transient. How did you control these switching losses? We never control the switching losses. Switching losses will definitely be there. They were there. They were around 20. You can refer to our papers. We had given a distribution of various losses occurring in various elements. You can refer to our paper, sorry. Any other questions, ma'am? Did I miss out any other question in the chat box?
Sir, how can we reduce the reactance? That's what they have given like that only, sir. Raja Satish Kumar, how the reactance is reduced?
Because reactance is not a term that is associated with DC. DC, you never have reactance. But then I would presume that it is inductance. Okay, then inductance value, something like walking on a tight rope. Inductance, if you bring down the inductance, smaller inductance will store only lower amount of energy, smaller energy amount will be stored. Therefore, you can't expect more power at the output. If you have a huge inductor, again, it's going to be big. Inductance value is large, then very, very big, it creates another issue. So it's a tight rope walk. You don't try to reduce the inductance, you don't try to have a huge inductance as well. Try to design based on the simple basic equations, which depends on ripple current. Frequency is one way. Of course, you can increase the frequency so that you can have a smaller inductance. That's all. It's not lower, you are not trying to break up. You definitely have to have reasonable amount of inductance for energy to be stored and transferred to the load side. That is a must. I hope this answers your question. Any other question, ma'am?
Whether interleaving techniques can be used in all types of converters?
Yes, ma'am. Madam Radhika ma'am has asked yes, you can use interleaving. In some converters, it may not be beneficial because it simply adds the number of components, but it doesn't give you the required or expected outcome, expected output. So you don't get that much benefit, therefore you don't use it. But theoretically, can you use? Answer is yes. Then Raja Sair has asked, if inductive reactance is reduced, stability is affected the grid side or load side. Sir, DC, we don't have reactance. So stability is not an issue due to reactance. In DC side, if you are residing in DC side, then stability is only going to be due to the voltage level. Reactance doesn't have a role. Right? This is one thing. Now, when you are in AC side reactance, how to treat? That's a well-known problem. You have grid inductance, you have your inverter inductance, source inductance will be there. Those reactances come into play. So at the DC side, you don't have any reactance effect. Simply voltage level at the DC side. I hope this answers you. Any other question, ma'am?
No, sir. That's it, sir. Thank you for your explanation. Patiently, you have explained very well, sir. I call Uma, ma'am, please.
Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks to the speaker, participants, and everyone related to this event. Thank you, sir, for your informative speech. We are able to enhance our knowledge on how the power converters are used in the DC microgrid. And I hope this speech will be very useful for many participants to enrich their research work in the field of DC-DC converters. I'm very thankful to all the participants for the valuable questions. From 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. And kindly, all the participants, make sure your presence by earliest around 3:45 p.m. to avoid the traffic. Thank you all.
Ma'am, can I take 1 second?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Prabhakar, sir, thank you so much, sir. This is Dhanlakshmi, sir. As being your student, I'm really proud to thank you, sir. I really thank you for accepting this invitation. And again, after a long time, I went back to my PG class, sir. As you were taught us, I remember my class session, and this is really useful, wonderful session. And I got a lot of information about converters. And we hope that in future also we need all these informations and knowledge from you, from your side, sir. And thank you, sir. Thank you for your wonderful session, sir. Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you, sir.
And not only Dhanlakshmi, sir, here also both the Karkoli volunteer, you know, both are here, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for your
SPC student.
SPC Karkoli and
all SPC alumni are here, sir.
So nice.
Thank you for your minute presentation, sir. Very interesting to see your class after a decade. Thank you so much.
Till now, we have received a lecture just only theory part only, sir. Now we have shown both the theory part as well as you proved practically with the papers, with reference and setup, sir. We are very happy to be here, sir, again. Thank you very much, sir.
So nice. So nice to hear all your comments. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Pleasure.
Once again, thank you, sir.
Yes. Ma'am, and I thank Dana, ma'am, for connecting such an eminent person to this FDP, ma'am.
It's my pleasure, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you to all the participants. And the meeting will be ending around 1:30. So it will be open until that, so that you can fill the feedback form. The feedback link is available only in the chat box. See to that you fill it. Thank you all. Sir, thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, can I have a copy of the video, ma'am? Because it's being recorded. Another participant, Dr. NMG Kumar, also wants that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We'll send you the record through mail, sir.
Okay. So that's available, ma'am. That's possible, right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Fine. Okay, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Sorry, we have taken more than the related time.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
This conference will now be recorded.